She was dubbed Australia's worst female serial killer, convicted over the deaths of her four children. But today, Kathleen Folbigg is a free woman, pardoned on all four deaths.
Ms. Folbigg has now been pardoned.
After 20 years and 15 days detained, today Kathleen Folbigg is free.
The manslaughter of her child Caleb, the infliction of grievous bodily harm on her child Patrick, and the murder of her children Patrick, Sarah and Laura. I have reached the view that there is reasonable doubt as to the guilt of Ms. Folbigg for each of those offences.
We are just so delighted for Kathleen, a poor, innocent woman who spent 20 years of her life being incarcerated for doing something that she never did.
She was one of Australia's most hated women, accused of one of the country's most heinous crimes.
I honestly and truly don't know her anymore.
Convicted of killing Caleb, Patrick, Sarah and Laura in the space of 10 years. Laura's death, the catalyst for a criminal investigation.
Kathy, did you kill Caleb?
No!
Did you kill Patrick?
No!
Did you try to kill Patrick on that near miss episode?
No!
Did you kill Sarah?
No!
Did you kill Laura?
No!
She is adamant that she didn't commit these offences, and 25 years is a long time if you're not guilty of an offence.
Entries from her diary forming a big part of the prosecution's case.
I knew I was short-tempered and cruel sometimes to her. Stress made me do terrible things.
Yes, I would have an angry thought, but it was never to harm her. It was always, why wasn't Craig here to help me?
Kathleen Folbigg was convicted on coincidental and tendency evidence. There was never any actual forensic or pathological evidence to say that the children were smothered.
As far as the public was concerned, the deaths of four babies could only be foul play. But in 2021, scientists said otherwise.
A fresh inquiry is underway focused on new scientific evidence.
Two eminent paediatricians testified today that it was likely Kathleen Folbigg's children died of natural causes.
What do we want?
Justice for Kathleen Folbigg!
90 doctors and researchers petitioned for Kathleen's pardon. They discovered two of her children had a gene mutation that could cause sudden, unexpected death, raising reasonable doubt over the proposition she smothered all four.
We know that science is moving at a rapid pace, and we need to find mechanisms for a more science-sensitive legal system to be created.
Kathleen Folbigg was released in private with a full pardon this morning. Consumed by hope, her friends say, rather than hatred over the decades she's lost.
Anger is not going to bring back 20 years of being incarcerated, 5 years of which were predominantly in solitary confinement. Hope is a better virtue.
Peter Yates, who we just saw in that story, is a friend and long-time supporter of Kathleen Folbigg, and he joins us now. Peter, how is she doing?
Extremely well. We were chatting this afternoon and she described what it was like to be able to stir a cup of tea with a metal spoon. She said she was feeling surreal. She's obviously incredibly grateful to the fact that she's been released. And like for all of us, this morning she woke up, she was going off to do her work routine. She did not know what was going to happen. And 56 minutes later, she was released from prison. It's a wonderful day for Kathleen and we're all incredibly delighted.
So she's finding magic in the mundane things of life. What else has she been doing since she got out?
I think she's just been chatting to Tracy. I know she's been doing that. She's been listening to the birds. When we were all chatting this afternoon, that the birds were so delighted to welcome her to her new freedom that we actually had to put them on mute. So she's having a fabulous day.
Did you ever think this day would come?
Look, we believe that science would eventually prevail, that sanity would eventually prevail and Kathleen would ultimately be released because the evidence on which she was incarcerated and the first inquiry just made no sense.
Peter, what was it about this case that made you get involved? You weren't a friend of Kathleen's. You weren't, like Tracy's, a long-time supporter. What was it that really piqued your interest and make you want to throw everything at it?
Well, I sit on the intersection between science and business and I'm also chairman of the Centre for Personalised Immunology at the ANU and our director was Professor Carola Vinuesa, and it was while she was there that she discovered the genetic disorder that the two daughters, Kathleen's two daughters, have. And Carola presented to a group of us how poorly she was treated as a scientist in the first inquiry. And that made a lot of us very unhappy. And then we poked our nose into this case and thought not only should we be unhappy, we should be outraged on Kathleen's behalf.
So she is freed. She's been pardoned. That technically means the convictions still stand. Like, they are still there, as a matter of fact. Will she seek to get them removed or quashed in some way? And if so, how will she do that?
Oh, yes, we're delighted that she's been unconditionally pardoned. So that means she can live her life reasonably normally. But until the convictions are quashed, she can't get a passport, for example. And so, yes, we will be seeking that the convictions are quashed as quickly as possible. And our appeal to the New South Wales legal system is please don't do what you've done to date, which is to drag every possible timeline out for as long as possible. It would be very disappointing if I'm sitting here in 2 years' time and sitting on this show and still talking about the fact that there's some reason in the New South Wales legal and judicial system why her convictions haven't been quashed. What do you think about that?
In the meantime, the New South Wales Attorney General says it's up to her if she wants to seek civil damages from the state, I guess sue, for the 20 years that she's had in prison. Will she do that?
Kathleen will be seeking every possible remedy for the damage that's been done to her life by the New South Wales legal system.
So what needs to change to prevent this from happening again?
Well, I think that there simply needs to be a better respect for scientific evidence in the New South Wales judicial process, and also there should be a review process, a proper independent process. The process that we've had to go through, it's called independent, but it's not. It is run by the Attorney General's office, it is funded by the Attorney General's office, and they gave Kathleen's side almost as little as money as possible. I mean, I think they spent $2 or $3 million on legal fees and allowed Kathleen to have 35 hours of legal time. We paid for all the experts to come from all over the world. We've paid for every possible thing you can imagine. And that's not available to a normal New South Wales person, I'm afraid. And so there needs to be a system set up where it is not one-sided.
Peter, we spoke to Tracy Chapman, Kathleen's childhood friend, last week, and she said that Kathleen had a few requests, a T-bone steak, a bath and some fresh pyjamas. But what comes next? How does then Kathleen rebuild her life after this?
Well, I think it has to be one day at a time. First of all, she needs the financial resources to be able to rebuild her life. We can't replace the life that she's lost, but to get the life she needs requires financial resources. That's well outside the role of philanthropists and well-meaning people. It is up for the state to make that decision of the scale of resources that she's entitled to. And of course, financial resources are going to help. But also, she needs love and she needs compassion. She's lost her four children, she's lost her life. And I know that the people in New South Wales will give her that love and compassion, and that will help her in her journey.
What a journey it's been. Peter, thank you so much for your time tonight.
Thank you very much indeed.